Hi, hello. We've got another giant climate report out, the third and final major part of the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change's sixth assessment report. The science report came out last August, and the impacts and adaptation report just came out a month ago. And finally, we've got the mitigation report. And a lot of people have been waiting for this one because they want it to be a roadmap for how we get out of this climate mess. The easy answer? Stop burning coal, oil, and gas. But how we do that is a totally different question. The summary for policymakers and the full report start in the same place, so we might as well too. How are we managing that whole rising temperatures thing?
Not great, Miriam.
Oh, hey there. That's Climate Adam, a fellow climate scientist and YouTuber. Alright, so it isn't great, but we have seen some improvements since the IPCC's fifth assessment report in 2014.
Yeah, well, around the world we've seen new laws and policies, which mean we've emitted less than we otherwise would have. This has made the worst case scenario, where the world heats up by 4 or 5 degrees Celsius, unlikely.
Alright, so progress.
Yup.
Enough progress?
Nope. Because emissions are still going up for every major greenhouse gas.
Continuing to use existing fossil fuel infrastructure puts us on a path well above 1.5 degrees Celsius of warming. We're already seeing stronger storms and devastating fire seasons with just 1 degree of warming, so keeping things below 1.5 should be our goal.
Well, the report doesn't actually say that.
I know, but it should have.
So the IPCC doesn't actually tell us what we should do, more what the consequences are of what we could do. And speaking of the consequences of our actions just aren't good enough to limit global warming to what the entire world has agreed would be safe.
What the report does make clear is that everyone's current climate targets created for the Paris Agreement also overshoot 1.5 degrees and make limiting warming to 2 degrees difficult. So building new infrastructure needs to be completely off the table. Looking at you, Enbridge. In the US, thanks to this law called NEPA, the National Environmental Policy Act, any federally funded project has to perform an environmental impact assessment. This report is pretty strong evidence that no fossil fuel project should ever get federal funding in the US again. Whether that happens is still another story, but still.
And did you know that other countries exist too that aren't the US?
I had heard that. Yeah.
And around the world, countries are getting better and better at talking about stopping climate change and then still investing in new fossil fuel infrastructure.
Of course, it'd be pretty hypocritical of us to knock talking about climate change, but what we really need is to replace fossil fuels with renewables everywhere we can. And according to this report, that is more doable now than ever before. The cost of solar, wind, and batteries have plummeted in the last 20 years. And as a result, we've been building more and more of them. Although, if we zoom in a bit, yeah, just a bit more, you can see that despite all this growth, renewables are still a small percentage of our overall energy mix.
Now, I know what you're thinking.
We need to increase those percentages as quickly and cheaply as possible.
And fortunately, the report has just the figure for you. It packs in a whole load of information, so let's break it down. It shows just how much each approach for decarbonization could cut emissions by 2030. So that's the length of each bar. The longer the bar, the better. I've heard that before. The colors of each bar show how cost-effective each approach would be. So blue bars mean you're actually saving money compared to what you're replacing, whereas red bars mean you're spending a lot more money. So in this case, the bluer the bar, the better. I've not heard that before.
Obviously, wind is crushing because wind turbines are majestic and beautiful.
Yeah, and solar is doing a stellar job too. So both have huge decarbonization potential and often save us money this decade. But this figure is also interesting to see what is less helpful. Take carbon capture and storage, for example. Often held up as some kind of magical silver bullet, we see here that its potential to cut carbon is actually pretty small. To make matters worse, it's seriously costly, so the only thing it actually has in common with a silver bullet is that it's pointlessly expensive.
Okay, we gotta talk about nuclear. I already know someone's gonna give me a hard time in the comments if we don't talk about nuclear.
Well, it could certainly help more than carbon capture and storage, but it's still pretty expensive and nothing compared to solar and wind, so take your comments up with the IPCC. Now, granted, this figure only takes us up to 2030, after which certain tech could become more effective or more cheap, But given that we need to cut carbon as quickly as possible and as much as possible, this is a pretty awesome cheat sheet on how to do exactly that.
But just cutting emissions isn't enough. To get into that, we need to talk about net zero.
Okay, so big picture. Carbon dioxide emissions are building up in our atmosphere like water filling up a glass. The fuller the atmosphere gets, the hotter the world gets.
So just turn the tap off. Stop emitting greenhouse gases. I said that already.
Yes, that is exactly what we need to do. But unfortunately, there are some carbon dioxide emissions that we just can't get rid of. So we need to cut our carbon emissions as much as we possibly can. And then we need to use some form of carbon dioxide removal, CDR, to suck up that last little bit of emissions that we can't otherwise cut. And this is what we call net zero emissions. The report makes absolutely clear that we need carbon dioxide removal. It is unavoidable if net zero CO2 or greenhouse gas emissions are to be achieved. In other words, if stopping global warming is to be achieved.
Which, I mean, let's hope it is.
But in the very same paragraph that the report points out that we need carbon dioxide removal, the report also points out that our ability to use this technology depends on developing effective approaches to address feasibility and sustainability constraints.
In other words, we know we're going to need to remove carbon from the atmosphere to solve this problem. But at the moment, we don't know how to do this. So we should probably work that out ASAP. Like the first two reports, there isn't anything new here. We've been talking about the need to phase out fossil fuels for decades. This report just piles together all the evidence, and there is a lot of evidence that we need to stop using fossil fuels as quickly as possible. This will require restructuring how global and local economies work, rethinking how and what we build and create, and as we do that, we cannot just focus on reducing CO2 molecules in the atmosphere. The whole point of this is to build a livable world we can all enjoy. So that restructuring needs to be done with equity and justice in mind. Thanks so much for watching. If you want to learn more about the Sixth Assessment Report, I made videos about part 1 and 2 here.
And I put together a video on exactly why the IPCC's reports are so important.
Which you can watch right here.
Bye. Bye.